Recorded Books and RB Digital present Moments We Forget by Beth K. Vogt, narrated by Jeanine Bartel. Chapter 1. I had half an hour, no more than that, to get my life in order so my sisters would never suspect how unprepared I was for this morning. I kicked the back door shut, dumping the plastic grocery bags onto the kitchen counter, easing the ache in my arms. If Joanna were hosting this morning, she'd have something homemade baking in her oven, the appealing aroma filling her immaculate kitchen. Well, one thing was for certain. I was not Joanna. Winston's frantic barks sounded from upstairs. Seconds later, he was scampering around my feet, his sudden appearance meaning I'd forgotten to lock him in his kennel. Again. Bad dog. A half-hearted reprimand. You're not supposed to be down here. I pulled items from the plastic bags. Please don't let me have forgotten anything during my mad dash through the grocery store. Cream for Joanna's and my coffee, although she was going to have to make do with my Keurig coffee maker, not French press. A small box of sugar so Peyton could enjoy her coffee with the preferred 3 heaping spoonfuls per cup. A pre-made fruit salad, blueberry muffins, Keurig pods. Nothing fancy, but at least I wouldn't look like a complete failure. I suppose to a casual observer, Joanna, Peyton, and I, the 3 remaining Thatcher sisters, appeared successful. And yet, while we might claim certain professional and romantic achievements, we still struggled to find our way as sisters. At times, Pepper's words, the ones Peyton had shared with Joanna and me several months ago, seemed more of a taunt than an encouragement. Sometimes you just have to forget all the other stuff and remember we're sisters. Shouldn't a role you acquired at birth be simple? Something you learn to do, along with walking and talking and navigating adolescence? But then Pepper's death at 16 splintered our already precarious bonds. I selected 3 mugs from a kitchen cupboard. This was no time to try to unravel the complicated dynamics between me, Joanna, and Peyton. Not when they'd be here any minute. And not with so much riding on this morning. It's funny how much hope people put into a cup of coffee. Social media, Facebook and Instagram and Twitter and Pinterest and even millions of people's text messages around the world overflow daily with memes and GIFs lauding the miracle qualities of coffee. Coffee is the gasoline of life. All I need is coffee and mascara. Behind every successful person is a substantial amount of coffee.
I drink coffee for your protection.
Drink coffee and do good. And now coffee would be the glue that bonded the 3 of us together. Coffee and a book. If Peyton's latest, "We should do this," idea succeeded. Despite our determination to try to be better sisters, to overcome the damage to our relationships caused by Pepper's death, and secrets, and not knowing how to even relax with one another, it was all too easy to succumb to a lifetime of bad habits. Of course, I knew my given position in the Thatcher sisters, volunteering to have our first Saturday morning book club meeting at my house. There were times I doubted that I'd ever get my "Is Everybody Happy?" theme song out of my head. It didn't matter that I had a full-time job, that I battled unrelenting fatigue, that Jeff and I were starting renovations on our house next week. I laughed and brushed off their multiple, "We can do this, Jillian," offers with lighthearted responses of, "I'm good, really, this isn't a problem at all." And then I'd resorted to a last-minute trip to the grocery store for pre-made options for this morning's breakfast. A girl has to do what a girl has to do, was fast becoming my mantra. Only I was doing less and less and hoping to get by. Winston scratched at the back door leading from the kitchen to the yard, distracting me from my musings on the power of caffeine mixed with a heavy dose of self-doubt. I bent down and ruffled his white ears before opening the door.
"Sorry to leave you sitting there."
He ran off along the chain-link fence, barking at a squirrel or a bird. "No, wait. That was our next-door neighbor, Gianna, out with her toddler."
"Good morning. Sorry about the barking."
I stepped outside, snapping my fingers.
"Hush, Winston."
"It doesn't even bother us.
Her daughter knelt, reaching through the fence. Oh, don't do that, Avery. I grabbed Winston's collar, tugging him back beside me. He won't bite, but he is a nonstop licker. We've talked about getting a dog, but right now my hands are full trying to keep up with a 2-year-old. I can imagine, but she's a cute handful. I checked my watch. Almost 9 o'clock. Joanna and Peyton would be here any time now. I'm sorry. I need to go. My sisters are coming over this morning. How fun. I wish I had a sister. Gianna took Avery's hand, helping her stand and brushing off the knees of her jeans. And I need to try and tire this one out so she'll take a nap for me later. Good luck with that. She tossed a wave over her shoulder. See you later. Come on, Avery. I released Winston. Gianna. Yes? I did mention Jeff and I are renovating our kitchen, right? My neighbor kept a firm grip on her daughter's hand, despite Avery's attempts to squirm loose. I noticed the huge dumpster in your driveway, a pretty big clue, and you also said you were thinking about it earlier this summer. I guess that thing is hard to miss. Winston sniffed around my feet. I just wanted to warn you there'll be workmen around during the day, but most of the noise will be inside the house. A friend is acting as our project manager, and he knows all the workers. Great. Thanks for letting me know. A knock at the front door as I entered the house signaled the arrival of one sister, most likely Joanna, who was always early. She greeted me with a quick hug, setting her leather purse and her book on the small oak table Jeff and I kept by the front door. At least she'd brought her copy of the book we'd chosen. The question was, had she read it? Good to see you, Joey. How are you? Tired. Joanna slipped off her leather sandals, looking trim in black capris and a red flowing top with cutout shoulders. Between my work and Beckett's schedule at the Air Force Academy, life's crazy. Still, it must be nice having him in the same state at least. He might as well have kept his original assignment in Alabama. The superintendent at the academy keeps him so busy dealing with speeches and briefings, and I don't know what else. We barely see each other. But you see him more than you did when he lived in another state, right? And not seeing each other was the norm for Beckett and Joanna. I'm not keeping track of hours and minutes. One thing I know is you and Beckett can do this. You've managed a long-distance relationship for years, which means you can manage crazy hours with both of you living in the same town. I remember how excited you both were the weekend he drove into the Springs. You're right, Jilly. I'm still getting used to this new phase. It was so sudden. Why don't you go make a cup of coffee? I apologize that it's from a plastic pod and not your preferred French press, but I do have cream. Had I taken the time to put it in the fridge? Peyton pulled up in front of the house as I started to close the door. I'll wait here for Peyton. Sounds good. My oldest sister disappeared in the light cloud of her cocoa perfume. Peyton released her long auburn hair from its ponytail as she half ran up the sidewalk. Hey! No need to run, you're not late. I lost track of time. She shook her head, strands falling around her shoulders. Well, come on in. We shared a quick hug. Do you want coffee or water? Both sound great. I'm dehydrated and under-caffeinated. A bad combination, especially if I want to get along with Joanna this morning. Don't start. I resisted the urge to shake my finger at Peyton. It was a joke. In the kitchen, Joanna had arranged the fresh-from-a-plastic-container muffins onto a plate. The pre-made fruit salad now sat on the counter in a white ceramic bowl. Thanks. I retrieved a serving spoon from the drawer. I could have done that. I figured I would make myself useful while I waited for my coffee. She gave Peyton a slow once-over. Did you just come from the gym? Technically, yes, but I was coaching, not working out. I met one of my JV girls for a private lesson. She wanted to work on blocking. She raised both hands, waving aside her explanation. Sorry if you're offended, big sister. I couldn't shower if I wanted to be here close to on time. Joanna hadn't commented on my casual attire of relaxed jeans and a navy blue Broncos t-shirt, a well-loved gift from Dad. But Joanna and Peyton would find something to bicker about, even if they'd taken a vow of silence. And me? I would always be the designated driver of the emotional vehicle that carried our merry little trio. You look fine, Peyton. This is a book club, not a formal affair. Grab yourself some coffee and I'll get your water. I retrieved a glass from the closest cupboard. I thought I could walk you both through the kitchen, tell you about our renovation plans, before we sit down and talk about the book. Zach was here last night, finalizing everything. There was no overlooking how Peyton's eyes lit up at the mention of Zach. Maybe someday soon she'd share more about their relationship. For now, she maintained a just friends demeanor and kept all details to herself. Of course, even friendship with the man she once blamed for Pepper's death would be considered progress by a lot of people. I still don't understand why our family, and Peyton in particular, is so chummy with Zach Gaines. Peyton stiffened at Joanna's comment. Zach helped us select these beautiful white cabinets. I spoke up, hoping if I kept talking I would divert the brewing tension. That he'll custom design and install for us. A few will have inset glass. They'll work so well with the countertops we picked out. The counters are made from pressed paper, if you can believe that. Pressed paper? Joanna's brow furrowed, as if I'd suggested we were using blue-lined notebook paper for our kitchen counters. It's a new green alternative. We selected a pewter color. Between enlarging the window over the sink and knocking out the wall between the kitchen and the dining room, everything is going to feel so open and light. Peyton finished chugging her glass of water, ignoring Joanna's glare. Zach told me that he also agreed to be the project manager. Jeff asked him about that when we first started discussing renovating the kitchen. What with Jeff taking on some extra projects at work and me being gone at the bank, we figured we needed someone to oversee the renovation. Zach talked with his boss, who agreed to a 4-day work week for him in the office and 1 day from home. My explanation was more for Joanna's benefit than Peyton's, who I'm certain already knew this. Jeff and I have so much more peace of mind knowing Zach is going to make certain everything stays on track. What else are you planning? Before I spoke, I prepped Peyton's coffee, silently counting off 3 sugars. We picked out dark wood floors last weekend, and I finally decided to splurge on a waterfall counter for the island. I also asked Zach to check on replacing the back door with French doors. Those will be expensive. Joanna found plates and silverware, obviously ready to eat. Yes, but my bonus was bigger than we expected, and Jeff had been saving for this before we got married. Besides, we want to do the kitchen right and not have any regrets later. Joanna offered both of us plates. You've been watching too many home makeover shows. My big sister was not going to talk me out of my fun or convince me to be more economical. Jeff and I knew what we were doing, and it wasn't as if we'd spent a lot of money on a lavish wedding. We're considering this renovation a belated wedding gift to ourselves. I added cubes of cantaloupe, honeydew, and watermelon to my plate. We're both ready to have this curling laminate pulled up, the old worn cabinets torn out. Jeff and I were looking ahead, not back over our shoulders at everything that had overtaken us during the past year after my breast cancer diagnosis and treatment. Why don't we each get something to eat, refresh our coffee if we need to, and go sit in the living room so we can talk about the book? Winston scratched at the back door again. I'll let Winston inside and put him in his kennel. Peyton selected a muffin, pausing to take the plate that Joanna held out to her. Oh, don't do that. He won't be a bother. Right. I couldn't help but laugh. We all have food. You know he'll wander around begging. We won't feed him, will we, Joanna? Joanna sniffed. I'm not the one who sneaks food to that dog. I'll behave. You're as bad as Dad when it comes to Winston. In a few moments, we were all settled, Joanna and I on the couch and Peyton in Jeff's favorite oversized chair, with Winston sitting at attention at her feet. Peyton made a display of ignoring Winston's whines. So, what did you all think of the first chapter? I don't like the idea of having to read a biography. I feel like I'm back in college. Peyton groaned. Joanna, you said that about the classics Jillian suggested, and this was the one book we all agreed on. Besides, I'm the one back in college. I just think we should have looked at more options. We made the decision to read this book. Peyton held up her copy. We all bought it. It's done. Before I could decide if I was going to jump in and referee this early, my phone pinged with a text message. This might be Jeff checking with me while he's finishing up at the gym. He probably wants to see if we need anything at the store. I angled the phone where it sat on the coffee table, ready to silence it. But instead of Jeff's familiar face,
Mom's name appeared. "How are you feeling today? You looked so tired lately that I was worried." But then Joanna explained that it's a common side effect of the medication you're on. What? I gripped my phone, rereading the message, ignoring the fact that Joanna and Peyton were both watching me. "Joanna, you're talking to Mom about my medication?" "What do you mean?" Joanna sipped her coffee, eyeing me over the rim of her cup. Before I could answer, there was another ping. "And I can understand if you're also upset that you can't get pregnant while you're on tamoxifen." "No." I pressed my lips together, struggling to think of what to say, how to respond to Mom's text, to what Joanna had done. If the first text was bothersome, the second one was as if Joanna had invited herself and all of the family, Peyton, our parents, to my various doctor's appointments. She might as well have included Beckett and Zach Gaines in the group, too. "You told Mom that I can't get pregnant?" Joanna's facial expression didn't change as she took another sip of her not French press coffee before replying. "What are you talking about?" "I'm talking about these two texts from Mom." I held up my phone. "She says you explained how my medication is making me tired and told her that I can't get pregnant while I'm on tamoxifen." "Oh, that. We were talking. I can't remember when. And she said she was worried about you." Joanna nibbled on a cube of watermelon. "I took the time to explain things to her so she would understand what was going on." "Why would you do that?" "Because she was worried about you." Joanna spoke slowly as if I needed her to enunciate so I would be able to understand. "I just told her things everybody knows. Fatigue is a common side effect of that medication." "Everybody knows?" My voice was getting louder, but I didn't seem to have any control over it. "Does everybody know I can't get pregnant? Did you post it on a billboard along I-25? "Now you're being ridiculous, Jill." My sister dismissed my questions with a shake of her head. "People know you can't get pregnant while you're on tamoxifen." "You know, Joanna," Peyton spoke up. "You know." "Of course I know. I'm a pharmacist." "That's exactly my point." Peyton was in full-on offensive mode now. "You had no right to talk to Mom. Will you just admit you invaded Jillian's privacy?" It was as if I could see my words, Joanna's words, and now Peyton's words swirling around me like a verbal tornado, the strength of it already threatening to pull me apart. Joanna leaned back. Peyton leaned forward, both of them ignorant of the increasing danger. "I shouldn't have said anything." I tossed the statement like a white flag. "Can we just talk about the book?" Peyton twisted to look at me. "Are you kidding me? Of course you had to say something. Joanna never should have talked to Mom without asking you if it was okay first." "You're both overreacting." With a wave of her hand, Joanna dismissed both Peyton and me. "Mom asked a few questions. I answered them. You, of all people, know about HIPAA and patient privacy, Joanna." Joanna gritted her teeth. "We're family, Peyton. Family takes care of each other. Family respects each other. You never have our backs." "It's nice to know how you really feel." "It is how I feel. It's how Jillian feels, too." And now I was being dragged into Joanna and Peyton's fight. "Don't speak for me, Peyton." Peyton's eyes widened. Then she crossed her arms. "Fine. Speak for yourself." I would if I thought anyone was listening. At last, I had my sister's attention. Being with Joanna and Peyton was like competing with athletes when you knew they played dirty and wanted to win at any cost. Silence. No one was saying anything, and none of us had been listening to each other either. "Did you have something to say, Jillian?" Peyton's voice was quieter, but there was an edge to it, an unspoken challenge. No matter what I said, one of my sisters would not be satisfied. Better to focus on the original reason we were together. "What I wanted to do today was have coffee and talk about a book." I glanced at my phone again, set it aside. Maybe I could let Joanna know how I felt about all this. Just say it and be done with it. Not find out Joanna had talked to Mom about my private life. "I don't understand why you're making such a big deal about this, Jillian. You would have told Mom eventually." "Maybe. Okay, yes. I probably would have talked to Mom. But that's the whole point."
I focused on Joanna, hoping she would understand. I would have told her. Not you. Me. How did Peyton and Joanna spend so much of their lives arguing with one another? Listening to them disagreeing, pushing and pulling for the chance to occupy the right position, always exhausted me. The rare occasion I stood up to Joanna wore me out within minutes. And now, with everything else going on, I might as well be trying to stand up for myself while running on an out-of-control treadmill. I don't understand why you can't see I was only trying to help. Mom was worried, and I gave her the information she needed so she would be calmer. It wasn't your place. Peyton stepped back into the conversation. Joanna immediately turned on her. I was talking to Jill. Confronting Joanna had been a bad idea. I was the peacemaker, not the one who challenged her. That was Peyton's role. To get through this first book club meeting, are we going to need to pretend we're back in elementary school and read our books in silence? My attempt at humor failed. Whatever fragile truce we declared the past few months seemed to rip apart. I think, Joanna stood, I'll just call it for today. I scrambled to my feet, causing Winston to jump up from where he was resting in front of the fireplace. Joanna, don't leave. Obviously, my attempts to help Mom are being misinterpreted, and I didn't come here to be attacked or to join a reading circle. And with that, Joanna collected her book and her purse and stalked toward the front door. Winston scampered around her feet, impeding her getaway. I covered my face with my hands, the slam of the door echoing in my head. I shouldn't have said anything. Don't be silly. Peyton sounded as if she wanted to laugh. Of course you should have. But now Joanna's upset. She wants you to think she's upset. She's made a scene and walked out, and she hopes you'll call her later and apologize. That way she doesn't have to say she's sorry. What? I peered at Peyton over my hands. Think about it. Has it ever occurred to you that Joanna likes to be upset? That she uses it to keep us in our place? Peyton offered me a smile. Whatever you do, don't call and apologize. You didn't do anything wrong. You didn't do anything wrong. Peyton slipped Winston a bite of blueberry muffin. And I bet you that Joanna will still be here tomorrow with everyone else to prep for the renovation. Colorado Springs knew how to do Septembers. The trees in our neighborhood were hinting at autumn with leaves changing to brilliant yellows and oranges and reds, even as the temperatures remained warm, but not in the why-is-it-still-so-hot range. September was like an anticipated visit with a pleasant friend who stopped by once a year and never overstayed their welcome. I looped my arm through Jeff's, my head just brushing his shoulder. His verbal command released Winston from a heel to walk in front of us. He's doing well at obeying you when we're out on a walk.
Better. He's doing better.
His eyes shielded by both his glasses and the brim of the baseball cap that tamed his unruly brown hair. Jeff tugged on the leash to remind Winston that he wasn't his own boss.
If he wasn't on this leash, he'd take off running for no reason at all.
It's such a nice afternoon, although I do look forward to seeing snow on the peak again.
Well, it's shown up in August before, so it's not impossible to happen any time now.
Jeff adjusted his long-legged stride to my slower pace. He probably wasn't even aware he'd developed the habit during the past months.
I just realized you never told me how the book club went this morning.
We may have had our first and last Saturday book club.
Oh, come on. What could go so wrong?
Well, Joanna walked out in a huff. Jeff chuckled.
What did she and Peyton argue about this time?
They didn't argue. Well, they did. But it started off with me and Joanna arguing.
You argued with Joanna?
Now Jeff had the nerve to laugh, his familiar full-on head-thrown-back burst of laughter that caused Winston to glance back at him.
I'm supposed to believe that?
I pulled away from Jeff. I know, right? What would you say if I told you I snapped at Peyton, too?
I would most definitely not believe that.
It was a mess.
I can see why you said it may be your first and last Saturday book club. The three of you couldn't even discuss a book together.
It had nothing to do with the book.
What was the problem then?
I found out Joanna talked to Mom, without my permission, about my medication and the side effects. about the fact I can't get pregnant until I'm off the tamoxifen.
Okay.
Jeff might as well have said,
"Is that all?"
Why aren't you upset about that? He shifted the brim of his baseball cap.
I didn't realize you expected me to get upset.
Jeff, that's personal information.
Joanna told your mom, not a stranger.
Why are you taking her side?
Whoa.
Jeff stopped on the sidewalk, turning to face me and bringing Winston to an abrupt halt.
No taking sides here. And if I was, I would be on your side. Just processing things out loud, which I will stop doing immediately because it's not helping either of us.
I leaned closer to him, resting my head against his chest. I'm sorry. I didn't realize how much it still bothered me. It didn't help that I was tired and nervous about not having done enough to make things nice for the book club.
I'm sure Joanna and Peyton were happy with what you had.
I told them about the kitchen renovation, and Joanna questioned all our choices, how much money we're spending. And then we'd barely started talking about the book, and Joe was complaining again. And Mom texted, which is how I found out she knew about my not being able to get pregnant. Jeff slipped his arm around my waist, easing me forward and started walking again. Maybe we should have said something up front to everyone, back when we decided to freeze my eggs. But it's a little late to rethink our decision to keep that private, right? Jeff didn't respond, keeping quiet like he often did when we talked about my cancer, and especially when we talked about the reality that I might struggle getting pregnant, always so careful not to upset me. A few more moments of silence and then,
"We'll figure it out together, like we always do."
Was I wrong?
Wrong.
To get upset about Joanna telling Mom. Jeff stopped again, his eyes warmed as he leaned closer, his kiss gentle.
You know I will always be on your side, Jill.
I closed my eyes, allowing the moment to lengthen, forgetting we were on a walk until Jeff jerked away as Winston pulled on the leash.
Sorry.
He gave me a slow wink. It's okay. I faced forward as Jeff allowed Winston to tug him along. So, tell me what's going on with you.
Work got interesting yesterday.
When is cybersecurity not interesting?
True. But yesterday my boss asked me to consider speaking at a conference on ethics and cybersecurity.
Ethics?
Yes.
Jeff ducked under a low-hanging tree branch, filled with leaves turning a bright orange.
There are different ways to approach the issue, so I need to figure out if I want to do it, and if so, what they're looking for.
They being?
My bosses. The conference is in Denver early next spring.
This sounds like a great opportunity.
It'd be different. I'm used to doing my work, coming home, maybe attending a conference. I've never even thought about speaking at one.
You'd be great at it.
Thanks for the vote of confidence.
How soon do you have to let them know?
They mentioned it yesterday. I said we'd talk again next week.
I know you need to think about it some more, but my vote is yes. He paused long enough to press a quick kiss on the top of my head.
And thanks for that.
This was a chance to support my husband, an opportunity to turn the spotlight off me, my cancer, and put it onto Jeff, onto something positive. This speaking opportunity was an indicator that things were better. Not perfect, but better. We were passing Gianna's house, almost home. I reminded Gianna about the kitchen renovation when we were talking earlier today.
Why?
Because workers will be around. Cars and trucks parked in front of our house. Possibly in front of her house. I just thought it was the neighborly thing to do.
Right. I hadn't thought about how the renovation might affect the neighbors. I mean, beyond the fact that they have to look at that dumpster.
Avery, her little girl, loves Winston. But Gianna says she has her hands full with a 2-year-old.
I can only imagine.
What would you want?
What?
Would you want to start our family with a son or daughter? Jeff adjusted his glasses.
I hadn't really thought about it.
No preference for a boy or girl?
No preference.
Jeff stopped by the gate leading into the backyard and handed me Winston's leash.
Here, take him on inside. I'll go get the mail.
We can get the mail. He jogged away with a quick wave.
I'll be waiting at the front door.
Okay, fine. That was a bit abrupt, but it gave me the chance to appreciate my husband as he jogged around to the front of the house. a moment to daydream about the day we'd go for a walk with our son or daughter. Of course, I'd learned not to think too far ahead, but it was good to allow myself to dream again, if only for a few moments. The Thatcher sisters were together 2 days in a row, a rare event now that we were all adults, and a risky one, given the interpersonal fiasco during our first ever book club meeting. Also risky considering how I had listened to Peyton's recommendation and hadn't called and apologized to Joanna. Hadn't made things all better. Of course, when Jeff and I talked more Saturday night, he'd agreed with Peyton, telling me not to call Joanna and not to worry so much. So it was 2 against 1 opposing me about contacting my older sister. Instead, to resist temptation, Jeff and I had watched a movie, and then I'd gone to bed early and slept late. It wasn't all an escape. Sleep was survival nowadays. Now my house seemed to overflow with people moving between the main floor, the upstairs, and the basement. The cupboards in the soon-to-be-renovated kitchen stood open, half empty. Mom faced the fridge, either setting the contents onto what little counter space he had, adding them to a pot of soup simmering on the stove, or throwing them into a big black trash bag. Peyton and Zach, who'd come later than everyone else because they'd probably attended church, wrapped and stacked plates and bowls in a large blue plastic bin. They didn't mention where they'd been, and no one asked, because Thatchers didn't do God. But Peyton seemed to be curious, thanks to Zach's faith. Joanna staked out her own corner and analyzed my spice rack, tossing outdated square tins and glass bottles into the trash. Where's Winston? Who let him out of his kennel? Winston! I stood at the bottom of the stairs that led up to our bedrooms. Did someone put him in the backyard? Yes, Dad has him outside. Mom leaned around the fridge door. If you're not careful, he's going to steal that dog one day. With my mischievous dog found, all I had to remember was what I'd been doing before I realized Winston wasn't in his kennel. Did you find those other plastic containers? Peyton closed an empty cupboard door. Right, I left them upstairs.
I'll get them.
Jeff gave me a quick kiss in passing. Zach offered to carry down more storage bins and followed behind him. I thought I'd done more to get ready for demo day. I pressed both hands to my face. But what with Jeff and I both working... We'll get it done. Peyton came and stood next to me, offering me a side hug. This is a great time to clean house. No pun intended. Mom will wipe down the fridge for whoever is picking it up later. Zach promised to make a run to the thrift store with the giveaway box. Joanna's going crazy checking dates on all your spices and canned goods, so you'll be all set when you're restocking your brand new kitchen. We all observed the invisible boundary lines, first set up by Joanna dragging the trash can over to the counter and turning her back on everyone. Enough distance so there was no discernible friction and no real conversation either. But working together was better than arguing. Jill, the fridge is empty and the veggie soup is simmering. Your dad wants to take Winston for a walk. As I moved away from the stairs, Mom nodded to where Dad now waited by the front door. Winston prancing around his feet on the end of his leash. Is it okay if I go with them? Go, relax. Tackling the fridge was a huge job. When we get back, we'll run to the store and get bread to have with the soup. You don't have to do that. Soup is always better with bread. I'll grab something for dessert, too. And it would make Mom happy to feed everyone today and to know Jeff and I would have leftovers tomorrow. Jeff stopped beside me.
All the storage containers go in the basement until after the renovation, right?
Yes, we just need to make sure they're labeled. Joanna spoke up from her corner of the kitchen, still facing the spice rack. Dishes, glassware, and utensils are labeled with blue duct tape. Food items are labeled with yellow duct tape, pots and pans, silver. Other cookware items, white. Okay. I guessed that rapid-fire announcement counted as talking to me. Sort of. You mentioned you were using a small fridge during the reno, so I made up a box of items for you and Jeff. She still hadn't looked at me. Keurig, paper plates, bowls, cups, napkins, plasticware. I tried to keep up with all she'd said. Colors, the items she'd put in the box. Where had she said she'd put it? Did you tell Jeff? No. Joanna tossed a quick glance over her shoulder. Do you want me to? No, it's fine, I just wondered. I would act like I was following along. It was what I did more and more these days. Struggle to follow along. Pretend. Joanna tilted her head, watching me as if she detected my confusion. I needed to choose to ignore one or the other. The confusion all around me or the confusion swirling inside me. And I needed to remember it was okay to forget things every once in a while. Everybody did that.
Where's the number of the guy who's coming to pick up the fridge?
Jeff, back with another question. Didn't I give it to you when we were talking last night?
No, you said you'd give it to me today. I want to call him and confirm when he's coming over.
Oh, right. I scrambled to separate today from the details of yesterday and something that happened several weeks ago. We posted the fridge on Craigslist, right? Jeff had grabbed a bottle of water off the counter and gulped half of it down while waiting for me to answer.
We were going to, but then you said that one of Harper's neighbors bought it to use in his garage.
Right, right. Now, if only Jeff would keep feeding me clues, bits of information that would help me remember where I'd left that phone number. I think his name was Rick, or maybe Ron?
Do you want to call Harper and ask her?
That would be easier, but I had written the information down. It wasn't like I could call my best friend every time I forgot something. Let me find the number. I know I have it. 10 minutes later, after searching the messages on my Facebook page, my texts, and my voicemails, as well as a pile of papers on my bedroom dresser, I found the information Jeff needed. It was like playing a virtual game of memory with my brain, flipping over different things to find the matching details and put together the question and answer I needed. No, 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 yes. And behind me, I left a pile of papers strewn across our bed, which I'd have to deal with later. What would be the next question that would cause me more mental muddle? Dinner was a welcome respite from a day of nonstop activity, and we didn't use any of the paper products Joanna had brought, thanks to Mom picking some up at the store, along with the bread, butter, half gallon of ice cream, and a tiny container of vegan Haagen-Dazs for Peyton. A lull in the conversation as we all sat around the dining room table seemed like the appropriate time to thank everyone for their help. I hope you all know how much Jeff and I appreciate everything you've done to help us get ready for tomorrow. I was careful to scan the table, making eye contact with no one specific for longer than half a second, if that. Beckett's sorry he got called into work. Joanna still didn't quite look at me when she spoke, but at least it seemed that comment wasn't meant for the group at large. We understand work trumps packing up our kitchen. Joanna offered me a glimpse of a smile. Thanks. I'll check with the guys one last time. Zach spoke to Jeff. Make sure they'll be here bright and early. I hope not too early. I know you're not sleeping well, Jillian. Mom's voice trailed off as she traded a look with my older sister. I mean, Joanna mentioned... And now glances were exchanged between Mom and Joanna, Peyton and me, Mom and me, an awkward game of visual avoidance. Somebody had to say something. Fine. I know you and Joanna have talked about my health, Mom, but I would prefer you didn't. Now, not only was I taking Peyton's advice and not apologizing to Joanna, but I was correcting her and Mom at the same time. In front of everyone. What little soup I'd eaten threatened to rise back up my throat. I tried to swallow, massaging my collarbone. I wasn't trying to talk about you behind your back. Mom's voice wavered. I understand that. Joanna's heated stare seemed to scorch my face. But Joanna shouldn't have discussed the side effects of my medication and the fact that I can't get pregnant while I'm on tamoxifen without talking to me about it first. I could almost hear Peyton cheering me on from the sidelines, adding an invisible cartwheel just for fun. But why didn't you tell me? Mom's question weighted down with the unspoken words. After all, I'm your mother. Silenced me for a moment, and then backed me into a corner. I'm sorry, Mom. The words whooshed out of me like helium from a deflating balloon. Maybe I should have talked to you sooner. If I had, I could have avoided all this. And with that simple apology, all was as it should be in the Thatcher family again. I'd assumed my expected place, which so often included an apology of some sort, and Joanna and Peyton were once again at odds, with me in the middle. Oh, Jill, I understand. Mom's smile encompassed my mistake with instantaneous forgiveness. You were trying to do what you thought was best. And I'd made a mistake. Now that I'd admitted it, everything was better. The world was right when I was wrong. It looked as if Peyton was going to say something, but Zack gave a quick, almost imperceptible shake of his head. She pursed her lips and exhaled, and said nothing. I waited for Joanna to step in, maybe follow my lead with her own apology. I'm sorry this was even a topic of discussion again. She stood gathering her bowl and napkin. I explained yesterday that all I was doing was answering Mom's questions, not attempting to invade anyone's privacy. Not quite the apology I'd hoped for. Joanna, don't try to make it sound like what you did was right. Peyton jumped past Zack's restraint. We're family, and like it or not, we are all affected by the fact that you had breast cancer, Jillian. I, for one, would rather talk about things, not hide things. Oh, there were so many things our family didn't talk about. How Pepper's death had affected Peyton, how it had affected all of us, how Joanna had read Peyton's journal and that led to the decision to send Peyton away for medical help when she was 16. We chose silence over words, again and again. My sister's words slammed against me, scattering what was left of any defense I tried to muster. I wasn't hiding when I decided not to discuss every little medical detail with my family. I was trying to deal with my life, one day, one reality at a time. If anything, I should have started and finished with the apology. I knew the routine and shouldn't have deviated from it. What good had it done? My family was horrible at respecting boundaries, and apparently the temporary ceasefire between the Thatcher sisters was at an end. Chapter 2. I could fix this. Given a moment, one single uninterrupted moment, I could fix this. First, I need to figure out what was wrong. Why my boss was standing in my office asking, "Where were you?" As if he were my father and I were some delinquent 15-year-old daughter sneaking into the house after curfew. "Jillian, why didn't you answer my phone calls, my texts?" I was at lunch. I searched my purse, and I didn't get any calls or texts. I ransacked the depths of my canvas tote bag. Chapstick, a metal tin of peppermint Altoids, an almost empty package of tissues, my car keys, two tubes of lipstick, my wallet, half a movie ticket, an endless assortment of crumbled receipts, one of Winston's chew toys. Oh, that would impress my boss. Where had I left my phone? Harper, my ever-reliable friend, slipped around me, deposited the bag containing my leftover lunch on my cluttered desk, and began opening and closing various drawers, finally producing my cell phone. "Here it is." Mr. Hampton remained facing me. "I'm so sorry. I left it." The words stalled in my throat. No sense in stating the obvious. "What did you need me to do?"
"Where's the closing package for the Spencers? Everyone's waiting at Ascent Title. They were supposed to close on their new house 45 minutes ago.
I stepped forward even as heat coursed through my body. "I emailed that to the title company right before I left."
"They never received it. They sent you several emails, called your office, your cell, and now they're calling me."
As if on cue, both my cell and office phones rang, the sound traveling up my spine and lodging in the base of my brain. I'll handle this.
"Do that, please."
My boss pivoted like a soldier on guard duty and left without another word. What can I do? The shrill rings of competing phones almost drowned out Harper's question. "Nothing." I took my cell and muted it as I eased into the chair behind my desk. "This is my problem." "Are you sure?" "Harper," I stopped, modulated my voice down from panic mode. "Just let me do this, please."
"Sorry. Tell me if you need anything."
As Harper disappeared with an encouraging thumbs up and a smile lighting her brown eyes, I answered my phone. "Jillian Hennessy, how can I help you?"
"Jillian, where's the blasted paperwork for the Spencer closing?"
The familiar voice of one of the loan officers over at Ascent Title seared my ear. I scrambled to remember his name. Jonah. "I emailed it to you an hour ago, Jonah." I powered up my computer.
"Never got it."
"That's impossible. I wouldn't deny being forgetful, but I know I'd sent that paperwork. I could even have Harper vouch for me, if I hadn't just banished her from my office, because I'd asked her to wait while I finished up. Did you check your spam folder?" I've checked everyone's inbox and everyone's spam folder. It's not in this office.
Jonah almost spat the words at me. I've got two angry parents in my conference room. Their three kids are hyped up on soda and cookies, and I've used all of my computer paper to color on. My receptionist had to take their dog, their very large German Shepherd, for a walk to get it out of our storage room. Did I mention my receptionist is allergic to dogs?
As Jonah talked, I scrolled through the emails in my sent folder. And there was the Ascent title email with the attached closing package. I switched to my inbox, only to find the email returned as undeliverable. I'd sent the package to an old, outdated email address. A groan welled up from deep within me and escaped through the phone.
What? What did you do?
I was right, and I was wrong. Even as my brain wanted to shut down, as my throat tightened, I knew I had to be professional and own my mistake, and then fix it. I accidentally clicked on the wrong email address. Then I left for an early lunch and forgot my cell phone, which is why I didn't respond sooner. Within seconds, I'd corrected my error and resent the information, but only after double-checking the email address. The package is on its way to you. I'm so sorry, Jonah. Really, really sorry.
I don't have time for apologies, Jillian, but you owe me.
With a click, the line went dead. I dropped the phone onto my desk, collapsing with my forehead pressed against my crossed arms. How stupid could I be? Not that I'd be asking that question out loud to give anyone the chance to volunteer an answer. Too many mistakes. Too many things left undone at the end of the day that were then waiting for me when I came to work each morning. Too many days that started off with me determined to do better, to accomplish everything I needed to do, to catch up. And by midday, fatigue overtook my best intentions. Confusion befuddled my brain, and anxiety strangled my confidence. An hour later, Harper tiptoed into my office, her exaggerated, wide-eyed glance left and right, tossing her black hair against her shoulders, was almost enough to make me laugh out loud. Almost.
All clear?
Yes. Crisis dealt with. I leaned forward, resting my head in my palms. I assume Mr. Hampton is in his office, letting me handle anything else that comes up.
What happened?
Harper settled into one of the blue cloth chairs in front of my desk. Before that, I need to say I'm sorry for snapping at you earlier.
Forget it. You were stressed.
Harper waved away my apology. Now tell me.
You heard what happened. The closing package went missing.
How? You saw me send it before we left, but I somehow clicked on the wrong email address.
Everyone's done that.
I ran my fingers through my short hair. Yes, everyone does that. But I used to be so punctual. And now I'm not. Everything takes longer. Getting ready for work, doing work, I don't remember things like I used to.
You need to give yourself a little time.
We just passed the 1-year anniversary of your diagnosis, Jillian. You're barely past your treatment. What happened earlier was an honest mistake. It was me making another mistake.
I jabbed my index finger into my solar plexus.
I come in late, I leave early.
With every word I said, I added to my ever-growing list of faults.
And this week has been even worse. What with the kitchen renovation being delayed, not that it's my fault.
Wait. What? The workers never showed up?
I've been so busy. I haven't had time to think about it. They're finally coming tomorrow, on a Saturday. They've promised Zach that they're finished with the other house project and that they'll start demoing our kitchen tomorrow.
You're only 5 days behind. It could get...
Don't say it, Harper. I wanted to plug my ears with my fingers like a little girl, but shook my head instead. I've watched plenty of home renovation TV shows. I made the mistake of doing a search online of kitchen renovation horror stories. I know it could get worse. Just don't say it, okay? The faint, spicy scent of roasted chicken and grilled peppers and onions tickled my nose. Why did I smell fajitas? Wait. There, on the corner of my desk, sat my abandoned white paper sack of lunch leftovers. Perfect. With one swift move, I tossed them into the wastebasket beside my feet.
What are you doing? I thought you were taking those home for dinner tonight.
I never put them in the fridge.
They're fine, Jill.
And you hardly ate anything at lunch.
No, thank you. My appetite is off.
A shadow filled the doorway of my office as Mr. Hampton appeared again, his glance skimming past Harper to me.
Jillian, could we talk in my office?
I half rose, wiping my palms against the material of my linen pants. Now, sir?
I don't want to interrupt.
His glance ricocheted between Harper and me.
15 minutes is fine.
As he disappeared, I collapsed into my chair, causing it to roll backward. Well, that's just perfect.
What?
He probably thinks we were sitting here wasting time talking about the latest story on the British royals.
I seriously doubt the man even knows William and Kate, much less Harry and Meghan exist.
And I work here, too. We could have been talking business. I repositioned my chair. What am I going to do, Harper?
Do? You're going to go talk to Hampton. It'll be fine.
But he came by and we were just sitting here.
Exactly. Harper stood motioning me to my feet. We were talking, not playing cards or surfing the internet, looking at clothes or vacation spots. Stop imagining the worst.
Harper ushered me out of my office with a pat on the back and one of her trademark positive thoughts.
Mark Twain said this, "I've had a lot of worries in my life, most of which never happened."
Despite her encouragement, today was almost as bad as the day I'd gotten the biopsy results, when I knew I had breast cancer, but didn't know how bad it was. No, nothing. Nothing would ever be as awful as that day. Cancer had snuck up on me the night of my engagement party, as soundlessly as my footsteps along the carpeted hallway between the bank's offices. Cancer had ravaged my health, undermined my future. I'd almost allowed it to destroy my relationship with Jeff, except he'd ignore my, "you can't love me," protests and prove me wrong. Now was not the time to remember all of this. I needed to be calm, unemotional. Not to assume anything and overreact. Mr. Hampton welcomed me into his office with a nod, indicating I should sit in one of the faux leather chairs positioned side by side in front of his desk. He looked as neat and put together at 4 o'clock as he had when he'd arrived at 7:30, his customary start of the day. Dark suit, light-colored dress shirt, patterned tie, shaved head, and the menthol aroma of some sort of aftershave lingered in the room. An abstract print in blue, yellow, and orange hung on the wall behind his desk, and a small window allowed some natural light in. A low bookshelf contained an orderly array of binders and books, and several family photos placed just so indicated that, yes, Mr. Hampton was a family man, too. My boss cleared his throat, but before he could say anything, I rushed ahead. Mr. Hampton, I wanted to apologize again for what happened. I accidentally clicked on an outdated email address.
Thank you, Jillian.
Mr. Hampton folded his hands on top of his desk.
I understand. And I hope you know that you've been an excellent employee.
He paused, his words putting me on alert. I shifted in my seat, maintaining both eye contact and silence. Mr. Hampton cleared his throat.
I also want you to know my decision is not based solely on what happened earlier today.
Your decision?
Yes. Jillian, I'm sorry, but your position here at the bank is terminated.
I swallowed, my mouth dry. You're firing me?
Again, I'm sorry.
My boss rubbed his palm against his bald head.
We both know you've had a challenging time with your workload the past few months. And it's not that I'm not sympathetic, I am. Things just aren't getting done in a timely or thorough manner. Your job here is a full-time position, but what with you coming in late and leaving early, you're still keeping part-time hours.
What was I supposed to say? He might as well have listened in on my earlier conversation with Harper.
It was understandable when you were originally diagnosed with cancer, with the expectation that you would eventually get back to your normal work schedule. And I know that you made every effort to maintain your hours and workload. What happened with the closing today is merely another indicator of your inability to keep up with the demands of your job.
He shuffled some papers on his desk.
I've talked with some of the management team, and they agree there are extenuating circumstances here. Confidentially, there are also some changes being set in place for the company.
I tried to keep up with what he was saying. Changes?
Nothing I can discuss openly at this time, except to say that there will be some downsizing in the months to come. The banking industry is more and more about digital interfacing. In light of all this, Jillian, we'd like to offer you a decent severance package.
He lifted a slim manila folder from his desk.
You can look this over, discuss the details with your husband if you'd like to, and let me know if it meets your approval.
I was being shown the exit in the nicest way possible, and also being asked if that was okay with me. My fingers trembling, my first attempt to take the folder failed. I couldn't even get fired without messing it up. What was I supposed to say? Thank you?
We'll talk on Monday. Is that all right with you?
Mr. Hampton saved me from trying to figure out the appropriate words. Yes, sir. Whatever was in the folder, I was as good as fired. It wasn't like I would turn down the offer. The only thing I had to figure out was how to tell Jeff. But right now, I needed to stay calm. Somehow be appreciative, although all my job training never prepared me to thank my boss for firing me. I needed to pretend I was some award-winning actress, playing the part of a gracious woman who smiled though her heart was breaking. Discover the technique for talking while fighting back tears. My gaze made it as far as the bridge of Mr. Hampton's nose. I smiled, hoping the action stopped my lips from quivering. Stood, shook his hand, heard my thank you collide with his. One more thing lost to cancer. My best friend did not take no for an answer. It didn't matter how many different ways I tried to decline her impromptu suggestion for a girls' night. Harper was having none of it. I know Jeff's working late, so there's no rush for you to go home. Harper tilted her head, one eyebrow raised, giving me her, I mean business, look. We'll be sitting down, not working out at a gym, so it doesn't matter if you're tired. I just don't want to. I stood next to her car in the bank parking lot, the manila folder in one hand, my purse slung over my shoulder, my sunglasses hiding the fact that I'd spent 5 minutes in the ladies' restroom crying. Not that crying had done anything except ruin my makeup, what little I wore. But when your eyelashes are almost non-existent thanks to chemo, mascara is a must. Which is exactly why we're going to do this. Besides, we got lucky. We got reservations at the melting pot. Me, you, and a pot of chocolate fondue. Harper laughed, slipping on her sunglasses. And no, I didn't intend for that to rhyme. See you there. With that, she rolled up her car window and drove away. I debated whether I'd meet her or just go home. But Harper was right. This was a good idea. And she didn't even know how my day had ended. I didn't want to be alone with the memory of being fired on constant replay in my mind. 30 minutes later, we sat in a small booth for two, sipping glasses of wine, while our waiter prepared the flaming turtle chocolate fondue, complete with milk chocolate, caramel, and pecans. I figured you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.